Pastor, I'm going to pray for you. Milt, you bring the pulpit. Lord Jesus. Hey, reach your hand toward Pastor.
Hallelujah.
Let's give him a boost today. How about that? Come on. Intercede for your pastor, church. Intercede. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Lord God, we thank you for Pastor Kitchens. He's a blessing to me and everybody in this building. And Lord, I pray he would speak with the authority that only you can give. Lord, I pray he would open the word of God and that we would receive instruction and confrontation. Lord, you change us. Lord, if there's things in our lives that we don't have lined up with you, we pray today we get it straightened out, Lord. Lord, we're listening to you through this man today. And I pray that you'd use him to speak to us in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Amen. Give the Lord a praise this morning. Amen. He's good.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Well, amen. You may be seated. And by the way, there's different ways to give. Some come to the front giving baskets. Some give in the boxes on the way out. Or you can give online. Pastor Ron whispered in my ear and said, Pastor, make sure you share that. I said, I will. And So again, we're going to go to the Gospel of Matthew this morning, chapter 21, chapter number 21. And by the way, do you ever get stirred up about anything in your life? I think I got a few Buccaneer fans here this morning, do I not? Well, yes, we get stirred up about things in life, and many times at sporting events, my mother-in-law is 91 years old. She may be listening to me right now. She's at home, but by the way, she was in the hospital. She's home now doing great. And she'll sit there like many of us, and we'll watch our favorite team, right, playing football or basketball, whatever it may be. And but I don't know about you, but sometimes my mother-in-law gets a little bit excited and emotional about what she's watching with her team. She loves college football. And I don't know about you, but I've noticed that sometimes she'll be sitting there, and while she's watching the game, she begins yelling and making emotional comments at the TV, thinking that they're going to hear her. Now, don't come down on her too much, because I know some of you do that in your homes, do you not? Well, we get stirred up about things. You know, sometimes you drive an I-75, those who have football teams or their favorite team, they have flags on their cars, and all the different things in their windows. And if you're watching TV, many times that camera zooms in, and you see people with weird-looking hats, right? Colored shirts and colored clothing to represent their team. Sometimes big bellies exposed and painted. Am I right? I'm just being honest, right? You see that. I mean, they do that. Well, I can tell you, we have a reason to be stirred up this morning. Just like those in Jerusalem on Palm Sunday had a reason to get stirred up. We're going to look at a passage of Scripture that many refer to as Palm Sunday. Because when the Lord Jesus, this is a week prior to his crucifixion, he'll be coming in. And as he rides in, he's going to be riding on a foal of a donkey. And so he comes in, and everybody begins cutting down palm branches, celebrating. And what you're going to find out is the entire city, listen, the entire city was stirred up. As a matter of fact, I looked up this word stir. It literally means shake, agitate, quake. It's used for earthquakes is what it's used for. Other translations said wild and excitement with that phrase, thrown in commotion. What I'm trying to tell you is when Jesus arrived in the city, my friend, they got excited. It was stirred up. And there's something about the presence of Jesus that will stir you up in your life. How many of you know that Jesus is here with us this morning? Am I right? He is here right in this room. As a matter of fact, if you know the Lord, he's inside of you. So we're going to give you a few lessons out of this text, but I know that you've been standing a lot. But we honor God's word by standing. We believe it's the inspired, the inerrant, the infallible word of God. So notice, if you will, in Matthew chapter 21, I'm just going to read, let me see here, just the first 11 verses. Notice. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you. And immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord needs them. And he will send them at once. This took place, notice this, to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet saying, say to the daughter of Zion. By the way, Zion is another name for Jerusalem, okay? The city of Jerusalem and the people. Behold, your king is coming to you, humble, mounted on a donkey, on a colt, and the foal of a beast of burden. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them, and they brought the donkey and the colt, and they put their cloaks on them, and they sat on them. Notice, or he sat on them. Most of the crowd, notice what they did, they spread out cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. We know it's palm branches from some of the other Gospels. That's why we call it again Palm Sunday. And the crowds went before him, notice, and followed him, and they were shouting, Hosanna! Notice that, Hosanna to the Son of David. So they were expecting that this was the Messiah. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was, what does it say? Stirred up. Notice saying, who is this? Now, they had heard about Jesus, but because the whole city was stirred up, they're really asking, is this the one? Is this the Messiah? Who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. May the Lord bless the reading and preaching of his word as you're seated this morning. I know we've had a long service. I want to try to be fairly brief this morning. And I'll do my best by faith trying to do this now. But what I want to share with you is several key things that I see in this text. Number one, notice Jesus entered Jerusalem affirming the authority of the scriptures. He enters Jerusalem affirming the authority of the scriptures, the Old Testament scriptures, the Word of God. What we have here is a prophecy written 500 years before this event. Written by which prophet, by the way? Zechariah the prophet. As a matter of fact, notice, I'm going to go all the way back and show you this verse. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Remember, that's the word for Jerusalem. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. And then, of course, we saw where Matthew just said, we read this. This took place to fulfill. Notice, to fulfill. And so what I'm trying to do in this first point is simply do this. I want to encourage you to believe in the authority, reliability of this book that I hold in my hand, the Bible. You see, we believe that this Bible is not just a book. I mean, this is the inspired book of God. His Holy Spirit, listen to me, he spoke through these men as they penned these words, making sure it would be infallible, correct, and without any error whatsoever. So think about this. Precisely the way 500 years earlier Zechariah gave this. Precisely the way Jesus is coming in. Now, I want to say this is simply one of the many prophecies in the Old Testament. You know, prophecy, fulfilled prophecy is really one of the reasons why that we believe Jesus was the Christ, the Messiah, the promised one to come. You know, the Old Testament said the Messiah would fulfill A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and lots of dots and all the way. You know, that's what the Old Testament says. And guess what? Jesus fulfilled A, B, C, D, E, F, all the way through. Everything that he said, everything that the Old Testament said, you find Jesus as fulfilled. By the way, they say, biblical scholars, they really believe there's about 300 prophecies directly fulfilled by Jesus, about him. Let me just give you a couple of these. Psalm 22, 7 and 8. All who see me mock me. Now this is written by, you know, David, the psalmist. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delights in him. Now notice that hundreds of years before the event took place. Now watch what Matthew says. And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagging their heads, saying, you who destroyed the temple and built it in 3 days, save yourself. If you're the Son of God, come down from the cross. By the way, aren't you glad he stayed on the cross? He could have come down if he wanted to. Question, was Jesus a trained rabbi? That's kind of a trick question. No, he wasn't a trained rabbi. But he was God in the flesh. He knew the word of God, right? But he was, you know, he was the son of a carpenter. So, no, he was not a trained rabbi. So what is Jesus doing? Did he kind of do these things just to make us think that he was the Messiah? Well, I really don't think so, and I'll give you some other reasons why I don't believe that. I mean, what is he doing on the cross, making these people wag their heads? I mean, here he is suffering and dying in agony. Is he making those below him? He's suspended up on a cross. Is he somehow manipulating them to fulfill prophecy? No, I think that certainly is not rational. It doesn't make sense. Here's another one. For dogs encompass about me, same psalm. A company of evildoers encircles me. They have done what? Pierced my hands. By the way, the hand, the wrist, was considered part of the hand during this ancient time. They have pierced my hands. In faith, by the way, crucifixion really was, this prophetic word in Psalms did not exist. They impaled people with poles, but they had not crucified. The Persians, Darius, crucified 3,000 of his political leaders. Can you imagine that? The Persian king. But they pierced my hands and my feet, and I can count, notice I can count all my bones. He's talking about the fact that he is so thin he can count his bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them. Watch this, for my clothing they're doing what? Oh, let's see, I read that somewhere else. Let's see here in Luke. Notice, I'm going to go back to John. Here it is in John. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments, divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier and his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top to the bottom. And they said to one another, let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who it shall be. Watch this. This was to fulfill the scripture, which says, they divided my garments among them. And for my clothing they did what? So the soldiers did these things. Now, are you trying to tell me that somehow Jesus on the cross was doing these mind games to make them fulfill prophecy? Again, that's just not rational. But guys, I mean, I've just given you a couple of things. I'm just trying to stress in this first point the reliability of the Bible. Let me tell you what Jesus said about the Old Testament. Look, when he said this to them, these are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me. And he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the scriptures. Now, what is Jesus doing? Do you understand that was the way that the ancient Jews referred to the entire Old Testament? The historicity of the Old Testament, the historical accuracy of the Old Testament. So what you have Jesus is doing right here. He says everything in the Old Testament is inspired by God and speaks about me. By the way, did you know Jesus talked about Jonah? He talked about Moses. He talked about Abraham. He talked about Sodom and Gomorrah. By the way, I want to recommend a book to you. If you have a challenge with your faith, listen, I am very sympathetic for those who do not believe in that there's a God. I understand within our culture, the secular environment, the humanistic thought there, I can understand why they don't believe. But I want to challenge you to do something. There's a book called I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. And what the book does, listen, if you read that book and be objective as you read it, he says, I don't have enough faith to be an atheist, by Norman Geisler and Frank Turek. And what they do is they'll demonstrate why you should believe. And really, here's the issue. Listen to me. It takes more faith to be an atheist than to say there's no God. And I wish I could go on that one, but I cannot because of time. The Bible says the grass withers, the flower fades away, but the word of our God, what does it say? Jesus said, for truly I say unto you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota nor a dot will pass from the law until all is being fulfilled. Do you realize this is the best-selling book on the planet? It's the most loved book. By the way, it's one of the most hated books. Isn't it ironic? Most translated book. Why is it still here today? My friend, because God wants to speak to you. He wants you to know the truth, but you got to pick the book up and read it. Let me just ask you this question. If a book was on the, let's just say the New York Times best-selling list for, for, let's say, 20 years. Maybe that's a book you ought to look at. All-time bestseller. Okay, so what I'm trying to tell you is believe in the reliability. Jesus comes in here. So I'm just saying you can believe the word in this book. You can believe the words in this book. You can trust them. And listen to me, you're going to be accountable. You will stand. Listen, if you don't know Jesus, you're going to hear these words one day in eternity from this preacher. I can probably now say little preacher because I think both my grandsons are taller than me. This little preacher. So what I'm saying, you can depend. Jesus is coming in fulfilling Scripture. Number two, so you can depend on the reliability of the Bible. Number two, Jesus entered Jerusalem declaring his lordship. Declaring his lordship. Let me ask you a question. What kind of a Messiah were the Jews looking for? Okay? Political leader, right? They wanted someone to come in who could overthrow the Roman government, free them from Roman rule. They were not expecting a Messiah like this. But I would just simply say this. They should have expected a Messiah like this because their Old Testament points to him, right? And not only that, he gets on this donkey just like Zechariah said, and here he comes. And not only that, though, listen to me. He healed the sick. He gave sight to the blind, deaf to the hearing. Listen, he even raised the dead. He gave them every reason to believe. And today, by the way, he gives us this church. We have the church. We've had preachers through the last several hundred years preaching the Bible. I mean, we are still preaching Jesus. Whoever would have thought that those 12 men, most of them fishermen, right? Judah, me and you look like the fish, right? A fisherman. He catches them, I don't though. Matter of fact, now hunters, you don't, when are you going to take me out fishing, Hunter? I heard about all those fish you guys caught. Yeah. So what I'm saying is, listen, he speaks to you and he gives us all different ways to understand and hear declaring his lordship, but you have to be willing to believe. But I just want to say, here he comes in as on this donkey, on the foal of a donkey, he said, hey, listen, I'm coming in. He's trying to tell them, I am your Messiah, that long-awaited Messiah prophesied about. You've been waiting and waiting and waiting. I'm here, and I'm going to declare it. Of course, the religious leaders didn't want to listen to that. By the way, why did he come in on a donkey? Well, number one, the Bible says it. He's fulfilling prophecy. But then secondly, he's one of humility, and he's one who is gentle. But I want to remind you, the next time he comes, he's not coming back on a donkey. He's not coming back to humble himself and go to a cross and die for your sins. The Bible says this in Revelation, notice. Then I saw heaven open, behold, a white horse, notice. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems, and he has a name written that no one knows but himself. Watch this. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, I think pointing all the way back to the cross. And the name by which he is called what? John says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Here's the word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, are following him on white horses. Listen to me. I think that's me and you. I can't get into that, but I can't tell you why I believe that right now, but I really believe that's me and you. From his mouth comes a sharp sword, which, notice, to strike down the nations. And he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has a name written. What does it say? King of kings and Lord of lords. My friend, he's not coming back on a donkey. He's coming back as the resurrected Lord Jesus who died for your sin on a cross, who was buried, and who was raised from the dead. But even though they did not recognize that they should have, what did they do? Well, many did celebrate him. Oh, they celebrate waving their palm branches. But listen to me. Some of the very ones who were saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, some of those very same ones within a week are going to say, crucify him. By the way, let me just kind of give you a little side here. How many know that Christianity has nothing to do with your emotional positions and how you feel emotionally? Am I right? I mean, you can get excited and run around the sanctuary, and if we had chandeliers, jump up there and grab one and swing on one. But listen, the bottom line is, no, it's not your emotions that saves you. It is your surrender, your faith, your commitment to Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Well, some despised him. Some celebrated him. Some despised him. You know, there's a lot of people who despise Jesus today. You know why? Let me tell you the real reason. Some say, I just don't believe in that. I don't want to deal with that. No, let me tell you the real reason. Because he confronts you with your life. He'll confront you with how you're living. He'll confront you with the choices that you're making in life. That's why people don't want to hear. Listen, you can go into a room and talk about Buddha and, you know, Confucius, all these religious leaders. But, buddy, you start talking about Jesus, people get real nervous. There's something about that name. See? Well, some, of course, despised him. Some rejected him. By the way, not all the Pharisees rejected him, but many did. And then some believed and received. So I want to just stress again, even though they're waving these branches, celebrating all this emotional stuff in their life, you know, the problem is many people want to choose the kind of Jesus they want. By the way, did you know people choose churches? They're looking for a church that agrees with how they want to live. I'm not here to be a pastor to say, okay, I want you to feel good. I mean, I want you to feel good. I want you to go out of here saying, hey, that was a great service. But no, I want you to sit in here and be confronted with the Word of God and have the Holy Spirit of God speak to you. You know, I got to be honest with you. So I've got to share the truth of the Word of God. Number three, Jesus entered Jerusalem knowing. And I put these little underlined words in here purposely. Jesus entered Jerusalem knowing what he would face. While he's 100% God and 100% man, right? He was God in the flesh, deity. That's why he was born of the Virgin Mary. What it was the festival that is celebrated all throughout the Old Testament and was celebrated every year? It was the reason why the Jews were delivered from the Egyptian slavery. What is the name of that festival? Passover. If you know your Bibles and you go all the way back to the Passover, how many plagues were there? Say 10. 10. The last one was the death of the firstborn. And so God instructed Moses, you take a lamb, had to be a male lamb, had to be innocent, pure, spotless, without blemish. Why? Because it pointed to Jesus. And you'll see that in just a minute. And you take that lamb, and you slay that lamb, and you take the blood, and you put it on the door frame of your home. And what did the Lord say? When I see the blood, I will pass over you. I don't have time to read it, but that's in Exodus chapter 12, 12 through 14. You can look that up. So every year on the Day of Atonement, they sacrifice a lamb. They say on this day, this is a week before Passover. How many of you think it's just coincidental that the week before Passover, Jesus Christ is coming in, and on that Passover weekend, he's going to be slain? You see, the Bible talks about Jesus being the Lamb, John the Baptist. Watch this. The next day, Jesus saw Jesus coming towards him, and behold, what's he say? He says, behold the what? The Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. Notice that. He points to the Lamb. Why Lamb? That's a strange thing. I mean, why is he called this man a Lamb? Because he's the promised perfect sacrifice from the Old Testament. Notice, if you will, in Revelation, that I'll just give you a couple of verses. And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne of the four living creatures, in the midst of the elders, stood a what? A lamb. Now watch this, as though it had been slain. Yeah, he had been slain, but he'd been raised from the dead, okay? Revelation 7:17, for the lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them and lead them to fountains of waters, and God will wipe away all their tears from their eyes. Hallelujah. Revelation 22, and there shall be no more curse, for the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. Now, here's the issue. Just like those in the Old Testament had to take that lamb, they had to apply the blood. Do you understand you have to apply the blood personally if you want to go to heaven? Listen, it's not your church membership. It's not being good. The Bible says there's none good, no, not one. There's none righteous, he says. It's not being good. It's not being religious. It's only by trusting Jesus, only by looking to the Lamb of God. Listen, that's why he came and died for your sins, because he takes his blood and he covers your sins and he forgives you. You see, Jesus came in knowing he would be rejected, arrested, humiliated, and scourged, and crucified. You know, whenever you think of Jesus, it's probably, and you know, we have the Lord's Supper. They had the Passover every year, the Jews. We have the Lord's Supper pointing to the cross and Jesus' death. I think there's two pictures you ought always think about when we have the Lord's Supper. This one is the first one. Notice the Lamb. Innocent, pure, without blemish, had to be a male. They say families would adopt this little lamb, get that lamb ready. Those kids got attached to that little lamb. But then it had to be sacrificed, see. Well, but then you best think about the next thing, because it always pointed to what? The cross. He became the lamb to go to the cross, see. That's why Jesus came, to die on that cross. Number four, Jesus entered Jerusalem to demonstrate his profound love for humanity. You know, a lot of people say, I don't really believe anybody loves me, or God doesn't love me, my friend. Let me tell you how much God loves you. Scripture says this, Romans 5:8. The Bible says this, notice, but God has demonstrated his love towards us. That's you, that's me, that's every person on the planet. And that while we're yet sinners, rebellious, disobedient, pushing God out of our life, I want nothing to do with God, he still died for you. Because he loves you and he wants to give you life and forgiveness and take you to heaven when you die. It says again, notice, demonstrates. How did he demonstrate it? He stretched out his arms. Couple things very quickly. Christ died, I'm going to give you a theological word. Are you ready? Vicariously for you. What does that mean? In your place. See, it's personal. He vicariously died for your sins. That is, the innocent for the guilty. He was innocent. He had never sinned, but for those guilty, say you and me, the Bible says, notice, for he made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So he died for you personally. It's a personal deal. Personal. He died voluntarily. Notice the Bible, Jesus said it, no one takes my life from me, but I lay it down myself. I have the power to lay it down, I have the power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father, he voluntarily, listen to me, he voluntarily stretched out his arms. He allowed those Roman soldiers to take those nails and pin him to that cross. He allowed that to take place. He was God in the flesh. He didn't have to submit to that, he did though. Why? Because he loves you. He loves me. He loves every person on this planet. He says, no one takes it from me. By the way, don't you think we ought to voluntarily submit to his lordship in our life for what he's done for us? And then he died victoriously for us. Gosh, there's so much about Jesus that's so unusual, but just as Christ on the cross are unusual, watch this. After this, Jesus, knowing all things were now accomplished, he's on the cross right now dying. That scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. By the way, another fulfilling scripture there. Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge and with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. And so when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, as a matter of fact, they say in the Greek it means with a loud voice, he said, it is finished. I mean, what a strange thing to say when you're on a cross. What do you mean it's finished? The whole reason why I came to the planet, born of the Virgin Mary, showed you who I am, did signs and wonders and miracles, healed people, even raised people from the dead. And he said, guess what? I'm going to give you one more sign. They're going to kill me, but 3 days later, I will raise from the dead. One more sign, if you'll just simply believe. See, it's finished. All this plan of God, all the way through the Old Testament, finally, that supreme sacrifice, Jesus on the cross. And then lastly, number five, Jesus entered Jerusalem calling for a personal decision. Yes, he's making a presentation to all the people as he comes in. He's riding in on this donkey, fulfilling scripture of Zechariah the prophet, saying, hey, I'm the one. Not only is he calling his nation for a personal decision, you listen to me, he's calling you and me to a personal decision. You said, I'm not going to make a decision. I want to remain neutral in my decision making. I don't want to make a decision for Jesus. My friend, here's the problem. You don't have that option. Jesus doesn't give you the option of remaining neutral because you said, well, let's see, because when you choose to remain neutral, you say, you know, I'm going to ignore the person who changed our calendar. Think about it. When you ignore Jesus, when you say you're going to be neutral, you're making a decision to ignore the very person by which all history has been dated. My friend, you're ignoring the one that the Old Testament says all these prophecies will be fulfilled. You're ignoring the one by which millions and millions of peoples, even astrophysicists, have given their lives to Christ. Lawyers, doctors, judges. Yes, some politicians. Some politicians have given their life. What I'm trying to tell you, his message can reach anybody if you're open. But it's a personal decision, and that's what he entered that city of Jerusalem that day, to make a personal decision. Jesus said, you can't be neutral, because Jesus said, he that is not with me is what? You're against me. He who does not gather with me scatters abroad. Speaking to Nicodemus. By the way, I believe Nicodemus became a born-again believer in Christ. Don't have time to get into that. But notice, Jesus said this, notice, he who believes in me is not condemned, but he who does not believe in me is. What does it say? My friend, you have no choice. Because if you've chosen to reject Jesus, you've made a decision. If you've chosen to ignore Jesus, you've made a decision. You say, Pastor, I don't like that. Well, you read your Bibles and see what it says. Here's what I'm going to say. You will make a decision one way or the other. One way or the other. Your decision will affect your meaning and your purpose in your life. Listen to me. We give our lives, how much energy do we spend on the internet, social media, all these things we do for what? I'm not saying, listen, it's okay to use that stuff. But I'm saying, how much time do we spend for the Lord that we say we know? Your meaning, your purpose in life. He's why you live. Listen to me. He is why you exist today, is Jesus. Your decision is going to affect your eternal destiny. You say, it's not going to affect mine. I'm just going to die and that's it. No, the Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the what? The judgment. My friend, when you're playing that kind of a game, you're playing a game with your soul, the eternal destiny of your soul. Have you even read the Bible? Well, I don't believe. Have you read the Bible? And then lastly, your decision is going to affect others around you, especially the ones you love. Jesus said, notice, I am the door. Isn't that kind of, think about, again, some of the strange things that he says. Jesus says, I'm the door. Jesus says, I'm the light of the world. Jesus says, I'm the bread of life. Jesus said, I'm the resurrection of the life. All these I am statements. He says, I'm the vine, right? All these strange things. I am the door. If anyone enters me, he will be saved. And notice, and he will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy, but I've come that you may have what? Life and have it what? How many of you are glad Jesus came in your life this morning? He's awesome. Let me show you a picture here. You know, there's lots of doors. Lots of doors in life that people try to go through that they think is the right door. Of course, the Bible says there's a way that seems right unto a man, but the way it ends thereof in the way of death. What door have you gone through? Here's the issue. Jesus said, I am the way. Look at it. I am the way, the truth, the life. Do you see that little definite article, the? That means there's no other way. I am the way. That's from the one who died and was raised from the dead. I am not only the way, I am the truth. People say there's no objective truth today. Okay, well, give me your wallet after church, because it really doesn't belong to you. There's no such thing as that truth. Give it to me and I'll take it for you, because I believe in truth. Give me all your wallets. Well, no, there is truth. Why would you get upset about that? Because that wouldn't be right. Oh, that wouldn't be right. Oh, there are rights or wrongs. Okay. No one comes to the Father except through, what does he say? Now, guys, I did my very best to present a very clear presentation. These are the lessons from Palm Sunday. And I don't know many of you. Some of you are visiting for the very first time. All I know is this: religion doesn't get you to heaven. Church membership doesn't get you to heaven. Baptism doesn't get you to heaven. Giving money doesn't get you to heaven. Am I right? Only one thing: saying, Lord, I'm a sinner. You died for my sins. I'm repenting of my sins, which means simply I am asking forgiveness of my sins, and I'm turning the other direction, and I'm going to follow Jesus all the days of my life. Have you made that decision? I hope you have, because one day when he comes, you will see him the second time. Right now we see him by faith, but you're going to see him face to face one day, and I pray that you're ready. Stand with me as we stand. I'm going to ask the prayer team to come. Prayer teams come. Let's just pray together as the prayer teams are coming and Pastor Travis is coming. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for Jesus. Lord, I just want to thank you for every blessing you've given us. And Lord, just as you spoke to those in the first century, you speak to us today. Lord, you want to give us life. Lord, you want to forgive us. You want to do it so much so that you died on a cross for our sins. And Lord, you just say simply to believe and trust. And Lord, if there's anybody here today who hasn't made that decision to believe, may they come down these aisles and pray with somebody to receive Christ. Lord, there may be others who need to recommit their life to Jesus. They're Christians, but they've drifted. And Lord, you're speaking to them. Others who feel, Lord, that they just need some encouragement through prayer today. And I thank you that, Lord, as we pray, you hear us. So Holy Spirit, lead us in this time in Jesus' name. We have prayer teams up here. The Bible says, you have not because you ask not. We believe God answers prayer. Maybe you need encouragement. Maybe you're going through a challenge in your life, a trial in your life. Listen, we've all been there. I've been there many a times. Have someone pray for you. Maybe a grandson, granddaughter, brother, sister, somebody. So Travis is going to lead us in a song, but you come as we sing.
The splendor of the King.
Oh, I love this song. God, maybe you just want to come and kneel at the altar. You come.
Clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice.
Yes.
All the earth rejoice.
Thank you, Jesus.
He wraps himself in light.
Hallelujah.
And darkness tries to hide and trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice.
Sing it out, church.
How great is our God.
Yes, he is.
Sing with me. How great is our God. All will see how great. How great is our God.
Listen, I realize if you've never made a decision for Jesus, it's not easy to come in front of a bunch of people. But I want to remind you that Jesus died on that cross. They stripped him and nailed him to a cross while those on the ground mocked him and just basically ridiculed him. Take a stand for Jesus today. You need prayer. Listen, he gave everything for you. Are you sold out to Christ? Is he your Lord? You come as we sing. Sing it out.
Age. Wow, what a powerful message from our pastor today. Well, if today is the day that you are ready to give your life to Christ, we invite you with a simple prayer. Lord Jesus, I am a sinner in need of a Savior. I believe that you are the Son of God, sent from heaven, died on the cross, and rose on the third day to give me new life. Lord Jesus, come into my heart and make me new. I pray this in your blessed and beautiful name, Jesus. Amen. We believe that if you've said the simple prayer, that you are now born again. We are so excited to take this journey with you to encourage you and take this step of faith with you, we invite you to visit us on our website at tabsarasota.org. We want to know that today you gave your life to Christ. Please fill out a connection card right there on the top of our website, and we want to get to know you. We invite you to join us this next Sunday, and as we step into Holy Week, that you would be encouraged and you would know that God loves you. Bless you on this beautiful Sunday, and we'll see you soon. Thank you.